ghost story now at 855-853-4802 or write in at realghoststoriesonline.com. You're about to enter the world of the unknown and quite possibly the undead. This is Real Ghost Stories Online.
That indeed it is. And on today's episode of Real Ghost Stories Online, your calls at 855-853-4802, sharing your real ghost stories, your experiences of the undead. Tony and Jenny Brewski joining you once again.
Hello.
It's always nice and happy.
Yeah.
The undead. Hi, Tony and Jenny Brewski. How are you? Regis Philbin and Kathy Lee Gifford here. How are you today? So, I'm excited. It looks like we got some interesting calls here to share from all over the country. Couple from my home state, it looks like here.
Yeah.
The land of cheese. Do they have the accents? Do they have the Wisconsin?
Not like ridiculous.
Yeah, saw the ghost there by the beer cheese cooler.
No.
Which everyone has in their home. You know, it's funny. The other night we were looking. Where did I say? I think it's like just a Facebook post. Speaking of like weird or interesting things, the beer cheese cooler. This was a picture of an office machine from the 50s, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, and it's like a water dispenser, as you'd have the normal water dispenser in an office. It was a cold whiskey dispenser.
Yeah.
And then there was a button for soda and or water. And it's like ice cold whiskey. And it just showed like some office lady there just filling up her little Dixie cup. And I'm just thinking, oh my God, this is, and apparently these things existed.
I guess so. Yeah.
I mean, I'm surprised that hasn't been in Mad Men. That seems like that would totally make sense there.
Well, they just had, you know, their setup. They had their office.
Yeah.
So they didn't have to go down the hall to the community whiskey dispenser.
Down the hall to the community whiskey dispenser. Wow. That's a concept.
Yeah.
Right there. Right next to, hey, Culligan Man. That's what the Culligan Man used to do, actually. Before everybody wanted to drink purified water. It was just purified whiskey. Anyway, I thought it was just kind of interesting and creepy all at the same time. 855-853-4802 is our phone number. We'll kick off the show today with a call that is coming in to us from Jesse in Wisconsin. Hi, Jesse.
Hey guys, I was just calling. I was listening to one of the old episodes you recorded probably about a year, well, not a year ago, because it's 2016 now, but in 2014, I don't remember which one, but you guys were talking about someone called in with an outer body experience of some sorts, and the question came about hospitals, and I'm not sure how true this is, but I know a number of people who work in the hospitals, and I just wanted to comment on like outer body experiences in the hospitals. The particular story I'm talking about that I've heard with you guys was, I guess someone died when they were a little kid on the operating table of like kidney failure or something. I don't remember what it was, and they had an outer body experience and witnessed their parents crying profoundly, and they were going to go to the tunnel and. Something told them not to, but anyways, they came back and the mom showed this child the slip stating that she or he, I can't remember what it was, did indeed die on the table for about 12 minutes. But anyway, I heard that from a couple of people that work in hospitals. Like I said, I'm not sure how true it is, but I heard that there's just some sort of writing inside somewhere. Somewhere above the hospital, and I guess the only way to see it is if you were a spirit of some sort, and they do this, and they put this writing, I guess, inside like the ceiling or something. I can't remember what it was, but somewhere where you can only see it, obviously, if you're a ghost or something. I mean, you can see it if you're a person, but it's inside the walls, so unless you're a ghost, you can't see what this writing says. But I guess they do this to clarify people's stories about them dying, having outer body experiences, or dying and coming back. And supposedly they're supposed to be able to read what this says inside the walls or some sort like that. But I just had that quick comment to make. Also, hey, I might as well share a little funny story, I guess you could say. it's a real quick story, so bear with it. I know I've talked a little too much, but anyway, I was around Halloween time. Me and my son were coming home one night, and it was just me and him, and he's scared of the dark, and at the time, we didn't have a lamp in our front room, and the only light that we had in the front room was the light shining in from the dining area. We live in an apartment. And I told him, I said, run across the front room, turn on the light. And, you know, he didn't want to because he was scared of the dark. And around this time, there was a lot of spooky things, I guess you could say, happening to the kids that I haven't witnessed or didn't witness. But he was scared to run across the dark front room, you know, to turn on the light. So, you know, I said, okay, I'll keep this door open so the light from the hallway can shine in. And then, so he's like, okay, he runs, he turns on the light. As soon as he turns on the light, he runs to the couch and sits down, and he looks pretty scared. I'm like, what's wrong, buddy? Like, why are you scared for? He's like, I'm scared of ghosts. I'm like, there's no ghosts in this house, don't worry. And like you said, it was around Halloween time, so he had his candy bucket on the counter in the kitchen. And, you know, we weren't in the kitchen. It was a small kitchen. You could see into the kitchen from the dining area. He's like, I'm scared of the ghost. I'm like, there's no ghost in this house. And as soon as I said that on cue, his bucket full of candy just fell off of the counter onto the floor. And he looks at me with the most terrified look in his eyes. And he goes, what was that? And that's why I said, don't worry about it. Just, you know, it freaked the hell out of me, but I didn't want to make it look like I was scared because, you know, it was really creepy because right on cue, the thing fell off the counter. You know, I just told him, I said, oh, it was the vibration for me closing the door. But I know in my head that that's pretty much impossible to happen since the door is way on the other side of the apartment. But he believed it, and, you know, I calmed him down. So, I mean, that was my story. I thought it was pretty funny that it happened on cue as soon as I said that there is no ghost in this house. So that was it. Yeah, but as far as my comment goes that I called about, I want to hear if anybody who works at a hospital currently as a CNA, a doctor, or whatever, knows anything about this writing, I guess, in the ceiling or something that people are supposed to see when they have out-of-body experiences. I'm not sure, so I'm curious to see how true that is. And if anybody can call in and give us details on that. I'll let you guys go. Highway is getting pretty packed right now. I just got off work. So, again, this is Jesse in Milwaukee. Have a good day.
That would be pretty pretty clever if they actually do that to verify whether or not somebody had an out-of-body experience. But I think you'd have to have writing all over the inside of the drop ceiling for that to actually work, because who's to say that they're going to see the whole ceiling?
I believe that there has been things like that done, and I don't believe it's like a standard in like every hospital, like, okay, new hospital, we must put the secret lettering in on the, you know, in X area of the building. But I know that there has been some studies done like that.
Mm-hmm.
I can't quote them. I know I've just heard the stories over the years, so I'm just kind of recounting what I've heard. Heard it from another you've been messing around. What song is that?
REO Speedwagon.
Yeah, okay. Thing that I heard was used, or I believe I've read about, was the LED boards,
mm-hmm,
that light up and put messages and stuff on them, that people were trying to test this in like surgical areas, things of that nature, where people commonly claim to have out-of-body experiences. And they would put different messages.
Okay.
To change it up. So it's not like, oh, you know, well, you didn't read this, and it's not the same message for every person,
mm-hmm,
where somehow it could, you know, somehow be transferred and they would know what to say. And they were able to change that up. I believe it came out as fairly inconclusive.
Okay.
That one specific study that did that sort of thing. Now, if he's referring to that, I don't know. I mean, it sounds fairly similar in line to that. Is there more things that go on? Are there more things that go on like that? I'm not sure. There very likely is. But that's a good question.
Yeah.
To open up to the medical community and see what their feedback is on that. If there's any stories surrounding that sort of thing happening.
Mm-hmm.
I really would like to hear more about that. Thanks for the question, and thanks for your story. 855-853-4802. It's one of those fun things. Hey, yeah, there's no ghost here. Bam.
Right. you've got to love those moments where you have to be a parent not showing fear for the sake of your child. I hate those moments where you're scared shitless, but you have to be all brave and not even let them know that you're scared.
No, honey, it's completely normal for there to be two red glowing eyes outside your window. Let me get you some more teddy grams.
Mm-hmm.
It'll all be good. All right, let's hear your story.
Hey guys, this is Christina from Atlanta. This is my third time trying to record. I keep getting cut off for some reason. Not sure why, but this is a bunk bed story. I'm just going to say it fairly quickly so I don't get cut off again. We got a bunk bed. My dad built it. Then weird shit started happening. We had a hallway ghost that you would see from the corner of your eye from sitting in the living room. You would hear typing in my room. I pulled the notepad up to see if we could get a typing or anything. Nothing would type. But I mean, there was definitely typing. The TV would turn on and off. I had a water bottle thrown in my head one night. The closet door is like one of those doors that was jammed shut, and you have to literally pull it with all of your force to open it. It would open like by itself all the time. Like no problem. There was no pulling on it. It was just open. I've had friends spend the night that their hair would be played with or someone would crawl in the bed with them. Multiple times I've had, I've had cats pass away in the past, and it would be like a cat jumped on the bottom of my bed, like the top bunk from the bottom bunk, because the bottom bunk was full and then the top was twin. So it'd be like the only way it would be able to jump on the top is from the full bed. So it'd be like it would jump and you would see like the cat imprint. But there was no cat. It was weird as shit. It always scared me. I never saw like an apparition, only that, that we called it the hallway ghost from the corner of our eyes. I never saw like a full apparition until I got older. And I saw a girl, when I was on my computer typing like on MySpace or Zanga or whatever it was. And, from the corner, I saw this girl, and she was, like, literally standing, like, right next to my face, and I turned, and she was right there, and I was, like, I screamed, ran out, and I don't know if this is all related to the bunk bed or not, but this is just when I first started realizing, like, paranormal shit going on in my house, and, I mean, my dad got visited by his dad when he passed away, paranormal shit, like, we never saw, like, full-on, my family didn't. I was the only one that saw that girl that one time. You would hear dishes clinking, like, someone was doing the dishes, but nothing was ever touched. The dryer would start on its own with no clothes in it. It was super weird, which that could be an electrical problem, too, but who knows. It's just weird shit, and I've had quite a bit since I was younger, and quite a bit of shit happened, but I have so many more stories, and I'll try to come up with them. I'll hear the stories and stuff, because I listen literally every single day. All I do is billing in a cubicle, and I just listen to your podcast all day long. I'm an EPP. I absolutely love you guys. You guys are like my family. Yeah, I love you guys, and I will call back soon. Okay, thanks.
If you can pinpoint it down to when all the stuff started happening, and it's when you acquired something new, be it a bunk bed or something else, pretty good chance that it has something to do with that.
Yeah. I still go back to there's something with bunk beds.
Mm-hmm.
There, something happened at some bunk bed factory, or I don't know. I don't know. It's just bizarre. I'd love to start taking inventory on what type of bunk beds we're talking about here. If it's wood, if it's metal, because there's different types of bunk beds.
Sure.
And if we can find a commonality with any of them. So if you have submitted a bunk bed story in the past, and you're able to, that's half the problem is probably these are gone now,
because
It's like when I was a kid, I had a bunk bed. Unless mom and dad saved it, you probably have no idea what the brand was or anything like that. But just as much information as you know about it. You'd know if it was wood or metal, probably.
Yeah.
But beyond that, it may be limited in knowledge. But whatever you have, whatever you know about the bunk bed that you had weird shit happening to you on, let me know.
Mm-hmm.
Email me or post it on our Facebook page or something. And then see if we can find any sort of commonality here. And I'm, you know, not like this specific brand. I mean, I don't know. We're just going to see.
Well, if they have that information, we'll take it.
Yeah, I'm just really curious because, you know, I'm guessing there's probably, you know, bunk beds that were made in the, you know, 70s or 80s, probably went out to several different companies. You know, it's mm-hmm. probably like, well, this furniture retailer got this one and this one got this one. And it, but I don't know. I'm trying to source where this all goes back to and why, because there's just, I don't know, it's just too much of it for it to be a coincidence.
Right.
It's weird. 855-853-4802 is our phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online. I'm going to take a wild guess and say it's probably wood. I don't know. When I picture these things, I picture wood bunk beds. I don't know. And I think that there's probably more, you know, more apt to have something with that anyhow.
Mm-hmm.
It's because it's something that existed longer than the fabricated metal that showed up. I mean, although who knows? Maybe there's some sort of bunk bed factory tragedy where somebody fell into the tank of metal and then they didn't find out till, you know, much later. And now, you know, Bernie's in all of the bunk beds, you know.
Haunting children across the country.
Exactly. Who knows? Hi, what's your story?
Hey, Brewskies. It's me, Jared, again, from Fairbanks, Alaska. I just heard my story on your show and I got really all excited. It got me very happy at work. Well, I got another. My last story, the one that you were talking about, I talked to you about, where you hear the, I heard the nails in, like, I don't know, fingers on the wall going around and comes to the window. Funny thing about that, after I told that, I called my friend, who was my neighbor at the time. I told him about that, and he goes like, oh, that's weird. And I was like, what? I've heard that around my house too as well. And I was like, are you serious? He's like, yeah, it started in my parents' room, and then the scratching sound went all the way around and came to my window and stopped right in front of my window. And he's like, did you look out there? He goes, yeah, I did. I actually popped my head out the window, and there was no one out there. I just went up, and he just told me he just went up and locked the door. But that's, I just wanted to give you a little information about that continuation. I thought it was pretty cool. He never told me that. I thought that was pretty awesome. But anyways, my story is when I actually turned 16, I had a bunch of friends come over. We were playing a dumb game called Manhunt, where my neighbor Josh, the one who's my neighbor, I was living next to the time, his name's Josh. He goes out in the dome area, the abandoned housing area that we all used to live, my parents used to live to a long time ago, the place that gives me the creeps. He goes out there and hides, and all of us go out there and try to find them. And with Nerf dart guns, I know, we just use our imagination. It was fun at the time. So I gave everybody walkie-talkies, trying to make it more cool and kind of make it look like alien hunting, you know. But so we were all chatting on there, and we all separated to look for my friend Josh. And I went in really, really deep part of in the woods area, just by myself. And I was trying to contact one of my friend Alex. I was like, hey, Alex, can you hear me? And there was no response. And all of a sudden, my walkie-talkie just, like, started getting, like, massive interference. I was like, whoa, what's going on here? And I kept looking at it. And, like, the numbers on it, the channel numbers kept, like, changing and stuff. And all of a sudden, like, a voice came through. It said my name. It said Jared. And it said, I was like, what? And all of a sudden it said, Jared, I see you. And all of a sudden there was radio interference again, and it was dead quiet. And I was like, hell no. And I just booked it out of there as fast as I can. There's a little light pole we have for our driveway and stuff. I just ran towards there, and like, I just waited it out until they found Josh, and then finally Alex on my walkie-talkie finally came through. He goes, hey, where you at? And like, oh, I'm by the light pole. Just waiting. He goes, oh, okay. And that's where everyone just rendezvoused. And I was like, hey, yeah, I'm done playing the game for today. Let's all hang out and play some, let's go play some video games. And but that was like the creepiest thing. I guess you'd call it EVP, but yeah. Again, thank you for sharing my story, and I hope this story is gets to be shared. All right, have a good one. Bye.
That's the kind of prank I would love to figure out how to play on somebody. But I don't think it was a prank. I think something was messing with him.
It's something great. You're not a prank puller, though.
I know.
You're not. Do you enjoy? Would you enjoy pulling pranks?
I would. Yeah.
Why don't you?
Because you're the only person I'd ever pull them on, and you know it's kind of hard to pull a prank when we live together, work together, do everything together.
You could pull a prank.
I don't think I could pull one off on you.
I'd pull
have
pranks.
To have too much prep time.
I pull pranks every now and then. Nothing really. But it's more like I make shit up.
You make shit up, and then you start to laugh halfway through it, and I know you're full of crap.
I'm really not good at that.
No.
Like, I can get, like, a sentence or two in, and then I'm just like, oh, this is so insane. It's, you know, I'm like a child when it comes to that. So I have to hone those skills in better. Someday. 855-853-4802 is the phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online to share your real ghost story with us. We would love to hear it. And of course, if you enjoy this program and you want to keep it on the air and get a ton of bonus episodes, nearly 80 of them, with some of our best stories, that's what the EPP program is all about. You sign up on the website, realghoststoriesonline.com, click become an EPP. And it ain't bad. So check that out. Let's get another caller. Hi.
Hey, this happened this summer, last summer, with me and my friends hanging around a campfire in the backyard. It was around 11:30 and two of our friends already left. And we were sitting around a campfire. Me and my two other friends were sitting there. We're talking. We weren't really talking about anything. And we were bored. So we just started talking about the old abandoned house that was right next to my friend's house, which we were camping in the backyard of. And well, what we heard and saw was the back door of the house open and close, and we were trying to figure this out, and there's no wind, it was completely dark, and there's no one there. So we were just sitting there, we're talking about it, and right after we stopped talking about it, we're completely silent around the fire, seeing if we can hear anything. And all we heard was the leaves on the ground crunching, as in footsteps, coming towards the fire. They stopped, and right when they stopped, we started talking about them. And while we were talking about them, straight ahead of us, all three of us saw a tall black figure move from the house of the backyard of the house to the wood line that was right beside us. And right when that happened, we all ducked into the tent. The campfire's still on, everything's still on. And so we were sitting in the tent, listening and looking outside the windows and stuff. And in front of us, towards the campfire, we saw a black figure moving across from left side to right side of the tent, back to the west again. And it just stopped. And right when we looked towards the house in a window, there's a light there that wasn't even on when we got there. But when we looked, the light was on. And that morning when we got up, we checked the back door. All the doors and stuff were locked. Everything was locked. The door that opened was locked. We looked around, saw no footprints whatsoever. No evidence of anybody actually being there. So to this day, it's unexplained by all three of us. We never talk about it. We just don't know what to say of it. My name is Devin from Pennsylvania. That was my story. Thank you for listening.
It's always fun when you have a collective group of people and nobody has any idea what the hell just happened.
Well, no, and there's no footprints the next day.
Yeah.
Something's just floating around outside.
That's I think, is one of the more disturbing type things that we have stories on, is that.
Mm-hmm.
Either that or you get, like, the really weird footprints. It's like, that's like a hoof.
Okay.
that shouldn't be, because what I saw was not a goat,
mm-hmm.
you know, or whatever, you know, hoofed animal, insert hoofed animal here. I don't know. Would you, Here we go. Oh, would you rather?
Okay.
We were playing this on our EPP episode the other day. Mm-hmm. And would you rather, and let's say you have to see some weird entity thing. It floats up to your doorway, and you can see it. It's out the door. And it goes away, and there's snow on the ground. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
You go out there. Shortly after, it has not snowed the night before to wash the fill those tracks in. It should still be visible if there's tracks there. Would you rather have nothing there? Just looks plain as day, as if, you know, nothing happened. And you know it wasn't the wind, it wasn't drifting, it just not there. Or would you rather have some hooves?
I think I'd rather have nothing there, because that means it's probably ghostly and therefore chances are couldn't do much.
What if it's a friendly hooved animal?
I don't want to take the chance of meeting any friendly hooved animals.
I wonder if elf wasn't hooved. No, elf had paws. Elf was kind of like a
elf.
Yeah, from Mirmac, the one that ate cats.
Oh.
Thank you for entertaining this moment.
Yes.
As if it were a serious subject.
Okay.
But yeah, Elf. Remember Elf? You know what I'm talking about,
yeah.
Right? Okay, yeah. He's like never like really gone away. Like every once in a while you see Elf in a commercial and you're like, oh, what the hell?
See, you sound like you're saying elf. Like I'm thinking like the...
Oh, like a Will Ferrell character?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Elf. How do you... Is there a different...
Elf.
Elf.
Like
it's my northern.
With an F.
See, I say it the same way.
Alf.
Elf. 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 Like Al.
Yes.
Elf. Huh. I just learned something new. A new way to enunciate the name.
Okay.
This is a special moment in the show. All right. Hi. Let's hear your story.
Hi. My name's Alondra, and I am from Nacogdoches, Texas. Well, growing up, it was just my mom and I, and we would rent out one of her sister's mobile homes. So, you know, being the only child, I wasn't really at home for so much. I was usually across the street at my friend's house. Well, one night, my mom and I just decided to stay in, and she was in the living room, and close to the living room was the master bedroom. Well, I was in the master bedroom, and I was just laying horizontally on the bed, and I was to the point where my feet were hanging off of the bed, and so I was watching TV, and the door to the room was closed, and so, I mean, my mom couldn't really see if I was asleep or not, but she just had the TV on, she was watching TV, so I was watching TV and I started to doze off and I had some covers on me. Well, the moment that I fell asleep, I was pulled out of my bed. I still don't know how to explain this. I was on the floor and I remember not being scared. But then I decided to check under the bed and there was nothing there, and that's when I started to get freaked out. And I started yelling for my mom, but she never came in the room. So finally I got up and I went to go check, and I was like, hey, why didn't you go in the room? She's like, oh, I didn't even hear you scream or like call my name or anything, but I called out for her many times. Well, that's my story, and I was just hoping if anyone had any related stories. Thank you.
So something was making it to where mom couldn't hear her scream as she's being yanked off the bed.
What I wonder in those situations is the person actually screaming? Are they getting sound out, or are they so scared that nothing is coming out? They think they're screaming.
Mm-hmm.
Or is something sucking the sound and like literally pushing it in another direction? That's I don't know. That's one of those things you never really gonna have a true answer to. But we have stories like that quite commonly where suddenly the sound is like muted.
Yeah.
Or missed or directed.
Right.
And only one person's hearing it, another person's not.
I think they can control who hears what, and I wouldn't put it past them to try and make it to where mom can't hear the daughter being tormented.
Mm-hmm. Where it's almost, it's like absorbing it.
Mm-hmm. Oh. but I don't know that that's just a regular old ghost that has that power.
Sure. Thank you for sharing your experience with us. You definitely picked the right place to share that and see if anyone else has stories of a similar nature. Let's get another caller. Hi.
Hey, Tony and Jenny. I'm just calling. I posted something on you guys' Facebook page about the abandoned house on Highway K near Fond du Lac. Tony told me to call in and tell you guys about my story. It's not super long, but I mean, it's pretty pretty creepy to me. So here it is. I guess one night, me and some friends were pretty bored, and we usually did around town. When we got bored, we'd like to look up things on the internet and find out what places were supposedly haunted, and we'd like to go check them out. Not only in town, but you know, around town. We've done it a couple times. But the one that specifically I want to talk about is the abandoned house on County K Road in Fond du Lac. So we get to the house, we park into the housing neighborhood that's next to it now. We get out, it's me and I want to say five or six other friends. It's a summer night, real quiet, clear skies. And this place is just surrounded by a whole bunch of trees. I'm sure you know, Tony. So we walk, we park the cars, we all get out, we congregate around the cars for a little bit, about 5 minutes before we head into the area of the house. And it was super, super eerie as we were walking up to this house. I mean, like I said, it was a quiet night. And as we're walking towards this house, the closer we get, the more we can hear, and I'm not over-exaggerating anything by any means. This is exactly how I remember it. The closer we get to the house, I remember hearing crows in the distance. You know, crows at night. I've never heard crows before that or even after that at night. So that was pretty weird to me. But the closer we get, the more and more crows we hear calling from the trees. Like, we can't see them, obviously, because they're black and it was nighttime, but you know, it was really eerie because it started one crow, and then the closer we got, you'd hear a couple more, and the closer you got, there'd be more. By the time we got up to the house, I mean, there was crows calling all around us. And when we got to within the premises of the house, the wind started picking up. Not a big, huge gust of wind. It was like a light breeze, but it was enough to, you know, push. There was a loose, like, gutter hanging off the house. It was, like, 2x4, not 2x4s, but just pieces of, you know, foundation of the house was swaying in the wind and making, like, creaking sounds. Like, you know, when you step on the floor wrong and it creaks, the floor creaks. So with the cawing and then the creaking of the wood, it made a really eerie sound. And I swear it was super quiet before we went up to the house. So I thought it was really weird that the closer we got, the more weird sounds we started hearing. And we get up to the, I think it was the front of the house where they had the huge window looking into the living area. Jenny would like that one. Looking into the living area. We look in the window, and it's really hard to see. It's super dark in there. We can see, like, people were in there prior to us, because we can see, like, graffiti on the wall. Someone painted a pentagram, you know, the star upside down with a circle around it. I guess the demonic symbol or whatever. I don't know. I'm not into witchcraft, so. But, so someone painted that, and, you know, we're looking into this thing, and nobody was making a sound. And I'm looking in the front room and the front area of the house, and then there's a hallway to the left of the room from where I was looking in the window, and I thought I could see what to me looked like a shadow man kind of standing in the corner just looking at us. I don't know if anybody else saw it, because I didn't mention it. I was kind of spooked out, but it was standing there for about 2-3 seconds, and then it was gone in a flash. I couldn't see it anymore. And some of my other friends, they wanted to try to get in the house. So we started walking to the back And that's where the, I guess they had a little den area back there in that side of the house. And it's all overgrown grass and everything. So we walk around the house. And as we have flashlights and stuff. And as we're walking, we notice there's a little hut way back of the yard in this house, closer to the dense wood line back there. And before that hut, there's a well. And we were walking, I believe it was a well. We didn't get that far. This is why. So we were walking towards it before we were going to go into the house to see what was over there, because the hut looked really horrible, like it caved in or whatever. As we're walking there, my brother's walking in front of me, then it's me, then it's the rest of the people behind us. And as we're walking, my brother kind of loses his balance and he jumps, you know, to the side. I'm like, and then he turned around and his eyes were so, so big. He turned around, he's like, dude, what the fuck? And I'm like, what happened? And he turns to me, he's like, did you just push me? And I'm like, no, I didn't touch you. I'm like 10 feet away from you. And then he goes, something just pushed me. And I was like, I thought you were tripping on something. He's like, no, something pushed me. He's like, that's creepy. I want to get out of here. So, I mean, I was like, just wait. Let's see if we can, you know, find something. Let's see if we can see anything. And, you know, so he's freaking out. And then I turn around and go back towards the den area of the house. And my other friend's trying to look for an entrance to the house. But as I'm walking up to the house, it was a loud bang on the window that's upstairs of the house. You know, it made me jump so high. I mean, that's where it sounded like it was coming from. I can't be certain that it was from there, you know, but it freaked the hell out of me. And there was a lot of our friends saying that they kept seeing things out the corner of their eyes while we were there. And it was just a weird experience, especially with the crows calling in the background. And it seemed like something out of a horror movie. And we were kind of looking around for a little bit, and that's about the time the cops came. So it was pretty weird. Yeah, the cops came and we didn't get tickets. They let us go with a warning. But man, it was spooky. It was something, I guess, you had to be there to just understand the feeling that was around this house. And we heard the story about somebody in a family went crazy and killed everyone and then killed herself, or all of that. And I mean, it was nuts. Just the feeling really made me, you know, question why I like doing this type of thing. But I got another story about when we went to visit the JFK prep building in St. Nazian's, Wisconsin, which was another story. But I would love to share that one with you guys too. That one was super, super creepy, super scary. So I look forward to, I mean, you guys could look forward to me calling again. So have a good day. Not too much of a good story for me, but crazy experiences, the shadow people, my brother's getting pushed, and then the bang coming from the window upstairs. So you guys take care. I love the show. Keep doing what you're doing. So I don't know. Thanks.
Thank you for sharing that story from the very creepy house down the road from where I grew up.
Yeah, and, you know, he got in and they were able to look around for a little while, but mm-hmm. that place is so heavily, I won't say heavily guarded, but it's under a lot of security.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not an easy feat to get in there, nor should anybody try.
No, I mean, it's an interesting thing because there's motion detectors all over that property, and probably for this specific reason, not necessarily for ghosts, but because they know nobody's living there and they don't want people coming in and stealing the copper or whatever. Man, mm-hmm. I don't know if there's even copper in there. It's such an old property.
Yeah.
But it's for that specific reason. But it was always so creepy about it is the fact that it's always been kept up. At least the yard has.
Mm-hmm.
The home itself has fallen into such disrepair that I know parts of the roof have collapsed, probably flooring. I know windows have been boarded up now at this point. But growing up, I mean, it was there. I mean, and it still is there, but it's fallen into such disrepair. I don't know how you could restore it at this point, but it is the atypical creepy haunted house.
Right.
It is one of the, and there's a lot of lore about it. Recently, an online publication, what was it? I'm trying to think of the name of it. And they did a story on it and they mentioned us in it, because we talked about this house several episodes back.
I don't remember what it was called.
But I do apologize for that. But it was talking about this very house. I'll find it here in a second. And there's a lot of rumors about that property. And he had mentioned one too about it, you know, there a murder. And as far as cultofweird.com, by the way, cultofweird.com, you can see the picture of the house. It's up there. It's called "What Is the Story Behind This Mysterious Abandoned House in Fond du Lac?" And that's the town that it is in. Really good, creepy pictures of it. But as far as I know, and I've heard a lot of about this house, and I actually have a friend who lives pretty much across the street from it, that story is not true.
Okay.
It was a Civil War soldier who bought the house, built the house. I believe hard times or some sort of tragedy struck the family, not like a mass murder or anything, just shit happened.
Yeah.
And then the house then was not occupied for, you know, after that. It was occupied for a short period. There's actually a second house right behind it I was unaware of that is completely collapsed in on itself, but it was like servants' quarters, if you will. I was unaware that's there. But there's some YouTube videos out there of people who have gone into this house, around this house, and they show that as well. But I don't believe, to the best of my knowledge, and from fairly reliable sources, that the rumors of, you know, the tragedies are pretty much bunk.
Mm-hmm.
But that still doesn't mean that the property couldn't be haunted, that there couldn't be something else behind it. It is very bizarre to me that this thing sat for so long. I know it was a doctor, I believe, in my hometown that had ownership of it for quite a long time, and he recently passed. I don't know who has the ownership now, if it's the family, the kids, or what, but he just kept, you know, it there. I don't know if the hope was restoring it sometime or what, but he did keep the property up, if just out of good gesture to the neighborhood of mowing your lawn. So get completely, you know, destroyed. But anyway, interesting property, and one that I don't know that I'll ever know the complete story on. It will be a sad day when I drive over there sometime and it's like torn down,
yeah,
or a tree has fallen on it or something. Because I don't think it would take a whole lot at this point for it to see its final demise. Here's a fixer-upper for you.
Right. That's exactly what I want.
My goodness. 855-853-4802 is our phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online to share your real ghost story with us. Let's go to Jonathan. Hi.
Hey, guys. This is Jonathan calling from West Texas. And big fan of the show. And wanted to tell you a story that probably happened around, I don't know, a couple of years ago. It was, I would say it was around 2012 or maybe 2013, but anyway, the story is me and my brother were doing a little contracting help with my mom's second husband, and we went to do the contracting, you know, work with him, and at this old, I guess, the story has it around town, there's an asylum that took place back in the day, because we don't have one, and there's one a few miles north from us, but we don't have one at the time that I live in. So basically, you know, they told me about it, they said it was haunted, so you know, I believe in spirits, ghosts, demons, poltergeist, and pretty much everything. I'm a big lore expert on pretty much supernatural. But anyway, they told me about it. You know, I really didn't believe them. I was like, yeah, they're just fooling me. They're just trying to scare me. So we arrive at the place, and at first I didn't think nothing of it. But, you know, it's a two-story massive. You know, they have to be at least over 200 square feet, huge land. You know, it's just really massive. Big. So we get there, and, you know, I asked my mom, you know, husband at the time, you know, can I, you know, check the place out, or you need a little work, or, and he didn't mind, so he let me check it out before we started work, you know. I'm like, cool. So I go up to the door, and it says keep out, you know, kind of like that, you know, post sign, you know, kind of creepy, but, so I go in, and the place is just, it has to be historical. This place had to be at least started in the, I would say the early 1930s, at least. Not sure. Pretty sure I'm wrong, but it was, you know, it was pretty old. So as I'm looking around, I'm kind of intrigued by this, place, just because everything's broken down and, windows are shattered, the walls are kind of torn apart, and I'm thinking, it was pretty creepy. So, I just start checking room after room after room, so I had, I forgot to tell you, by the way, I had my dog, she was a yellow lab, yellow Labrador. Her name was Ruby, and I had her with me, and she was always standing by my side. She was very good in command, so I really didn't worry about her. So she was with me, and start looking around, and I'll go into this room that looks like it was an office before, and it was turned upside down. So I was, it was a desk, by the way. So even ahead of myself, but the desk, when I walked into this, this office, this little room, this big room, I noticed this this desk upside down. So I was like, that's kind of weird, just the room itself. It didn't give me chills right away. It just, it was just a little bizarre how the room took place, so to speak. So, checking out this room and just, I thought it was cool. So, I'm taking pictures, taking little videos of it. And, I'm checking out this room. I decided to look out, check out the whole entire place. So, as I leave the room where the desk sits over at, I hear this glass break, kind of like if you were to slam, not a bottle, a glass bottle, but just some kind of, taking a rock and then, just throwing it at a glass window and then how the sound that it shatters, kind of like that. So I hear this noise on the top floor, and I was like, what the hell? So my mom's husband comes in at the time, and he's like, hey, you checking it out? It's cool. I was like, yeah, it's pretty cool. But I just heard a glass break on the first, the second floor. He's like, what? Because he's in charge of the place at the time doing construction. So I told him, so he went to go check it out. So he did. And I found it kind of weird, thinking about it. I was like, man, either there's homeless people in here, kind of got spooked, maybe they heard me in here, or, two, it's probably, it always is that answer where, it's probably, the undead or the, the supernatural, whatever you would like to call it. So I didn't think anything of it. So I start to search the room with, the rest of this building out. So, I'm looking around and I come across the stairs to go to the next floor. But in between the stairs is the boiler room. And, I kind of find it weird how the boiler room is just like in between the whole stairs of the this facility. So, I kind of look down a little bit of it, and I'm getting this like weird vibe, not that I can't move my body or anything like that, but just like this weird vibe. So, I keep staring and I just can't quit staring at it. It's like something took a hold of me. So I keep staring at it, and I just out of nowhere, telling the truth there, I hear like a child cry. It creeped me out. So I'm like, whoa. So I go up to the second, I got kind of spooked. So I didn't run, but, I go up to the second floor and, go to where my mom's, husband was at. So I go up there and, see where he was at, and I met up with him. Well, right before I met up with him, out of nowhere, I hear glass, the same sound and glass break, but this time on the floor that I was just on, the first floor. And I thought, okay, now that can't be a homeless person or, tired hitchhiker, you know, there's no way. But, you know, that's just, it's impossible. If it is, you know, it's pretty messed up what I'm doing there right now. So, you know, he gets really irritated, so he runs back down there to see what it was. So I'm checking this place out and telling you, man, just things, you know, graffiti everywhere. It was just real creepy. So I come to this elevator shaft, and just looking down it just gave me goosebumps. Like bad chills, bad goosebumps. You're like, you know, what the hell? So at the time, you know, I got my dog Ruby and we left the house. And as I left the house, I left the door open. And the day, you know, it was, I think the weather at the time was summer. Yeah, it was summertime. So, I left the door open. No wind was blowing and the door started to close by itself. I was like, what the hell? So I opened it, you know. So I opened it more and it kept doing it, you know, vice versa. I kept doing it, you know, and I was like, what the heck? So, you know, we ate lunch after that and Jeff worked a little bit. And at the time we were getting to work, my mom's husband was, he was on his riding lawnmower and out of nowhere he could just hear him yell and he cuts the lawnmower off, his lawnmower off. And he just starts yelling and, you know, cursing. And, you know, me and my little brother, you know, go up to him. We're like, hey, you know, what's going on? And he was like, well, he goes, you know, something just hit me. Like, something just threw something at my face. And, you know, it was kind of weird. So he said that it comes, that the angle was thrown and it had to be from the second floor. So we go back, you know, and a little bit after that, nothing really happened. So we kind of just continued just working. And he told me, he was like, man, he thought that was creepy. This place has a basement. And I was like, oh, yeah, definitely. I have to check this out. So a little after that, he opened up the basement door because that kept locked as well. Facility. So he unlocked the door and he goes, I have to stay here because the door shuts, will get locked out. You can't open it from the inside. And I was like, okay, kind of weird. And I told him, I was like, man, please don't do nothing. Don't scare me, you know? because to be honest with you, you know, it's not hard to scare me. So basically he held it open. And in a little while, my little brother told me, he's like, no, you can go with him. So, it, you know, so he, my little brother had the door open for me and for us to go, you know, check this place out, search it out a little bit. So I go down there, and the stairs down there, it's a huge balcony, you know, a balcony of stairs that you have to go through. So we go down them, you know, and we go down it, searching out, and it was a huge, huge basement. He was telling me the story where that back in the day, that this place used to be a little opera house, little auditorium. And I was like, oh, that's cool. So I'm just checking out the auditorium. And at the time, you know, the basement didn't have no light. So we had to use our, you know, our flashlights. And, you know, we had a couple flashlights and the flashlights on our phone. And the weird thing about this part of the story is when we used the flashlight, the batteries and the flashlight went dead. And the thing about it is, he told me that he just bought those batteries for the flashlight. They ran out the last day, yesterday, prior to this time. So, you know, and I found that extremely, extremely weird, considering the fact, you know, I'm thinking now, like, it's just draining the, you know, the energy out of the battery, just to, you know, give him some kind of, you know, life, so to say, you know? So I'm thinking, okay, that's kind of weird. Well, out of nowhere, my cell phone starts to ring. And at the time, the ringtone I had, you know, it was a rock song, and I can't remember what the rock song was. And so it played, and, you know, I tried to get to it, see who it was, and, you know, inside the balcony when my cell phone went off, you know, and I'm standing in this auditorium where, you know, supposedly these, you know, these little kids used to have opera dates and things, you know, it, you know, it was kind of, you know, not creepy, you know, I was a little, you know, impressed by the, you know, things that they would do here, you know, because it was kind of, you know, huge, you know, fan of just classic music in general, but, Anyway, cell phone goes off, and the second cell phone goes off, I can hear little kids sing, opera sing, like, you know, that you're in an opera. And that was where I was like, you know, what the fuck? I was thinking, no, this cannot be happening, man. So, you know, I was kind of, and now at the time, you know, my blood's rushing, man. You know, I'm kind of like, you know, freaking out a little bit. I'm like, no way. So I was in there, you know, with my mom's husband, and he was talking to me, you know, we're just doing our thing. And I see, you know, this thing has corridors, you know, huge corridors. So I'm looking around, and, you know, he just stops. Like, because, you know, he just stopped like he's frozen, but he wasn't talking to anybody. Like, he was faced with something that, like, he was talking to somebody. So I was like, man, he's got to be messing with me, right? So I go up to him, you know, I was like, hey, man, is that okay? And he was like, well, we got to leave. And I was like, why do we got to leave? And he was like, because. He goes, there was something that just told me that you need to get out of here, that your God does not scare me. And that was like my, my that was it. I was like, yeah, we got to go. So, you know, I was like, you know, when we left and closed the door shut and never really thought of anything after that. I mean, you know, I started recently listening to your show and, you know, thinking about it, hearing all the other amazing stories that y'all broadcast. And, you know, it's just spooky, you know, you just think, you know, and I just, you know, one thing is, you know, I really can't stand people that are skeptical about the whole, there's no such thing as ghosts or spirits, because, you know, they do exist, you know. I mean, the way I see it, the way I was raised up to be was, if you believe in God, you have to believe in the devil. It's just that. It's the truth. It can't be, you know, there's good, but there's also. Anyway, guys, I appreciate the time. Enjoy the show. And I really hope that I can have my little story broadcasted on your show. And I have I have a couple more that's actually happened to me, and cool. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your story with us.
I think when you start to see batteries drain, or you know you've just put fresh batteries in something,
mm-hmm.
something's sucking the energy out, and it's not doing it just to annoy you. It's doing it because it's probably getting ready to do something.
It's trying to use it for its own.
Yeah, like I think it sucked all the battery juice to try and make the singing
sure
music.
And you'll have that too with beyond just batteries sometimes. Sometimes you get people feeling very suddenly weak, very cold, very, it's almost like that energy
mm-hmm.
is being sucked as well. So any place where there's an actual source of energy or something, sometimes you do see that occurring when something's trying to manifest itself.
It's your cue to run.
In one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Thank you for sharing the story with us. Do greatly appreciate that. Of course, if you like the show, please support it. Help us stay on the air. Sign up to be an EPP, extra podcast person. Go to the website, realghoststoriesonline.com, and click Become an EPP. Until next time, for Jenny Brewski, I'm Tony Brewski. Thanks for listening to another episode of Real Ghost Stories Online. This one and this one got this one, and it, but... I don't know. I'm trying to source where this all goes back to and why. Because there's just, I don't know, it's too much of it for it to be a coincidence.
Right.
It's weird. 855-853-4802 is our phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online. I'm going to take a wild guess and say it's probably wood. I don't know. When I picture these things, I picture wood bunk beds. I don't know. And I think that there's probably more... You know, more apt to have something with that anyhow.
Mm-hmm.
It's because it's something that existed longer than the fabricated metal that showed up. I mean, although who knows? Maybe there's some sort of bunk bed factory tragedy where somebody fell into the tank of metal and then they didn't find out till, you know, much later. And now, you know, Bernie's in all of the bunk beds, you know.
Haunting children across the country.
Exactly. Who knows? Hi, what's your story?
Hey, Brewskies, it's me, Jared, again, from Fairbanks, Alaska. I just heard my story on your show, and I got really all excited. It got me very happy at work. Well, I got another my last story, the one that you were talking about, I talked to you about, where you hear the, I heard the nails in, like, I don't know, fingers on the wall going around and comes to the window. Funny thing about that, after I told that, I called my friend, who was my neighbor at the time. I told him about that, and he goes like, oh, that's weird. And I was like, what? I've heard that around my house too as well. And I was like, are you serious? He's like, yeah, it started in my parents' room, and then the scratching sound went all the way around and came to my window and stopped right in front of my window. And he's like, did you look out there? He goes, yeah, I did. I actually popped my head out the window, and there's no one out there. I just went up, and he just told me he just went up and locked the door. But that's, I just wanted to give you a little information about that continuation. I thought it was pretty cool. He never told me that. I thought that was pretty awesome. But anyways, my story is when I actually turned 16, I had a bunch of friends come over. We were playing a dumb game called Manhunt, where my neighbor Josh, the one who's my neighbor, I was living next to the time, his name's Josh. He goes out in the dome area, the abandoned housing area that we all used to live, my parents used to live to a long time ago, the place that gives me the creeps. He goes out there and hides, and all of us go out there and try to find them with Nerf dart guns. I know, we just used our imagination. It was fun at the time. So I gave everybody walkie-talkies, trying to make it more cool and kind of make it look like alien hunting, you know. But so we were all chatting on there, and we all separated to look for my friend Josh, and I went in really, really deep part of the in the woods area, just by myself, and I was trying to contact one of my friend Alex. I was like, hey Alex, can you hear me? And there was no response, and all of a sudden, like, my walkie-talkie just like started getting like massive interference. I was like, whoa, what's going on here? And I kept looking at it, and like the numbers on it, the channel numbers kept like changing and stuff. And all of a sudden, like a voice came through. It said my name. It said Jared, and it said, I was like, what? And all of a sudden, it said, Jared, I see you. And all of a sudden, there was radio interference again, and it was dead quiet. And I was like,
I'm of my like the top bunk. From the bottom bunk, because the bottom bunk was full, and then the top was twin, so it'd be like, the only way it would be able to jump on the top is from the full bed. So it'd be like, it would jump, and you would see, like, the cat imprint, but there was no cat. It was weird as shit. It always scared me. I never saw, like, an apparition, only that, you know, that we called it the hallway ghost from the corner of our eyes. I never saw, like, a full apparition until I got older. And I saw a girl, when I was on my computer typing, like on MySpace or Zanga or whatever it was. And, from the corner, I saw this girl, and she was like literally standing like right next to my face, and I turned and she was right there. And I was like, you know, I screamed right now. And I don't know if this is all related to the bunk bed or not, but this is just when I first started realizing like paranormal shit going on in my house. And, I mean, my dad got visited by his dad when he passed away. I mean, just, you know, just paranormal shit. Like, we never saw, like, full on, well, my family didn't. I was the only one that saw that girl that one time. You would hear dishes clinking, like, someone was doing the dishes, but nothing was ever touched. The dryer would start on its own with no clothes in it. It was super weird. Which that could be an electrical problem too, but who knows? It's just weird shit, you know. And I've had quite a bit since I was younger, you know, and quite a bit of shit happened. But I have so many more stories, and I'll try to like come up with them. Like I'll hear the stories and stuff, because I listen literally every single day. All I do is billing in a cubicle, and I just listen to your podcast all day long. I'm an EPP. I absolutely love you guys. You guys are like my family. Yeah, I love you guys, and I will call back soon. Okay, thanks.
You know, if you can pinpoint it down to when all this stuff started happening, and it's when you acquired something new, be it a bunk bed or something else,
mm-hmm.
pretty good chance that it has something to do with that.
Yeah. I still go back to there's something with bunk beds. Mm-hmm. There, something happened at some bunk bed factory, or I don't know. It's just bizarre. I'd love to start taking inventory on what type of bunk beds we're talking about here. If it's wood, if it's metal, because there's different types of bunk beds.
Sure.
And if we can find a commonality with any of them. So if you have submitted a bunk bed story in the past, and you're able to, I mean, that's half the problem is probably these are gone now.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's like when I was a kid, I had a bunk bed. Unless mom and dad saved it, you probably have no idea what the brand was or anything like that. But just as much information as you know about it. I mean, you'd know if it was wood or metal, probably.
Yeah.
But beyond that, you know, it may be limited in knowledge. But whatever you have, whatever you know about the bunk bed that you had weird shit happening to you on, let me know.
Mm-hmm.
Email me or post it on our Facebook page or something. And then we see if we can find any sort of commonality here. And I'm, you know, not like this specific brand. I mean, I don't know. We're just going to see.
Well, if they have that information, we'll take it.
Yeah. I'm just really curious because, you know, I'm guessing there's probably, you know, bunk beds that were made in the, you know, 70s or 80s probably went out to several different companies. You know, it's mm-hmm. probably like, well, this furniture retailer got.
Online. Call in your real ghost story now at 855-853-4802 or write in at realghoststoriesonline.com. You're about to enter the world of the unknown and quite possibly the undead. This is Real Ghost Stories Online.
That indeed it is. And on today's episode of Real Ghost Stories Online, your calls at 855-853-4802. Sharing your real ghost stories, your experiences of the undead. Tony and Jenny Brewski joining you once again.
Hello.
It's always nice and happy.
Yeah.
The undead. Hi, Tony and Jenny Brewski. How are you? Regis Philbin and Kathy Lee Gifford here. How are you today? So, yeah, I'm excited. It looks like we got some interesting calls here to share from all over the country. Couple from my home state, it looks like, here.
Yeah.
The land of cheese. Do they have the accents? Do they have the Wisconsin?
Not like ridiculous.
Yeah, saw the ghost there by the beer cheese cooler.
No,
which everyone has in their home. You know, it's funny. The other night we were looking. Where did I say? I think it's like just a Facebook post. Speaking of like weird or interesting things, the beer cheese cooler. This was a picture of an office machine from the 50s, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, and it's like a. Like a water dispenser, as you'd have the normal water dispenser in an office. It was a cold whiskey dispenser.
Yeah.
and there was a button for soda and or water, and it's like ice cold whiskey. And it just showed like some office lady there just filling up her little Dixie cup. And I was just thinking, oh my God, this is, and apparently these things existed.
I guess so. Yeah.
I mean, I'm surprised that hasn't been in Mad Men. That seems like that would totally make sense there.
Well, they just had, you know, their setup. They had in their office. So they didn't have to go down the hall to the community whiskey dispenser.
Down the hall to the community whiskey dispenser. Wow. That's a concept.
Yeah.
Right there. Right next to, hey, Culligan Man. That's what the Culligan Man used to do, actually. Before everybody wanted to drink purified water. It was just purified whiskey. Anyway, I thought it was just kind of interesting and creepy all at the same time. 855-853-4802 is our phone number. We'll kick off the show today with a call that is coming in to us from Jesse in Wisconsin. Hi, Jesse.
Hey, guys. I was just calling. I was listening to one of the old episodes. You recorded probably about a year. Well, not a year ago. It's 2016 now. But in 2014, I don't remember which one. But you guys were talking about someone called in with an outer body experience of some sorts. And the question came about hospitals. And I'm not sure how true this is, but I know a number of people who work in the hospitals. And I just wanted to comment on like outer body experiences in the hospitals. The particular story I'm talking about that I've heard with you guys was, I guess someone died when they were a little kid. on the operating table of like kidney failure or something. I don't remember what it was. And they had an outer body experience and witnessed their parents crying profoundly. And they were going to go to the tunnel and something told them not to. But anyways, they came back and the mom showed this child the slip stating that she or he, I can't remember what it was, did indeed die on the table for about 12 minutes. But anyway, I heard that from a couple of people that work in hospitals. Like I said, I'm not sure how true it is, but I heard that there's this some sort of writing inside somewhere above the hospital. And I guess the only way to see it is if you were a spirit of some sort. And they do this, and they put this writing, I guess, inside like the ceiling or something. I can't remember what it was, but somewhere where you can only see it, obviously, if you're a ghost or something. I mean, you can see it if you're a person, but it's inside the walls. So unless you're a ghost, you can't see what this writing says. But I guess they do this to clarify people's stories about them dying, having outer body experiences, or dying and coming back. And supposedly they're supposed to be able to read what this says inside the walls or some sort like that. But I just had that quick comment to make. Also, hey, I might as well share a little funny story, I guess you could say. It's a real quick story, so bear with it. I know I've talked a little too much. But anyway, I was around Halloween time. Me and my son were coming home one night, and it was just me and him. And he's scared of the dark. And at the time, we didn't have a lamp in our front room. And the only light that we had in the front room was the light shining in from the dining area. We live in an apartment. And I told him, I said, run across the front room, turn on the light. And, you know, he didn't want to because he was scared of the dark. And around this time, there was a lot of spooky things, I guess you could say, happening to the kids that I haven't witnessed or didn't witness. But he was scared to run across the dark front room, you know, to turn on the light. So, you know, I said, okay, I'll keep this door open so the light from the hallway can shine in. And then, so he's like, okay, he runs, he turns on the light. As soon as he turns on the light, he runs to the couch and sits down, and he looks pretty scared. I'm like, what's wrong, buddy? Like, why are you scared for? He's like, I'm scared of ghosts. I'm like, there's no ghosts in this house, don't worry. And like you said, it was around Halloween time, so he had his candy bucket on the counter in the kitchen. And, you know, we weren't in the kitchen. It was a small kitchen. You could see into the kitchen from the dining area. He's like, I'm scared of the ghost. I'm like, there's no ghost in this house. And as soon as I said that, on cue, his bucket full of candy just fell off of the counter onto the floor. And he looks at me with the most terrified look in his eyes. And he goes, what was that? And that's why I said, don't worry about it. It just, you know, it freaked the hell out of me. But I didn't want to make it look like I was scared, because, you know, it was really creepy, because right on cue the thing fell off the counter. You know, I just told him, I said, oh, it was the vibration for me closing the door. But I know in my head that that's pretty much impossible to happen, since the door is way on the other side of the apartment. But he believed it, and, you know, I calmed him down. So, I mean, that was my story. I thought it was pretty funny that it happened on cue as soon as I said that there is no ghost in this house. So that was it. Yeah, but as far as my comment goes that I called about, I want to hear if anybody who works at a hospital currently as a CNA, a doctor, or whatever, knows anything about this writing, I guess, in the ceiling or something that people are supposed to see when they have out-of-body experiences. I'm not sure, so I'm curious to see how true that is, and if anybody can call in and give us details on that. I'll let you guys go. Highway is getting pretty packed right now. I just got off work, so again, this is Jesse, Milwaukee. Have a good day.
That would be pretty pretty clever if they actually do that to verify whether or not somebody had an out-of-body experience. But I think you'd have to have writing all over the inside of the drop ceiling for that to actually work, because who's to say that they're going to see the whole ceiling?
I believe that there has been things like that done, and I don't believe it's like a standard in like every hospital, like, okay, new hospital, we must put the secret lettering in on the, you know, in X area of the building. But I know that there has been some studies done like that.
Mm-hmm.
I can't quote them. I know I've just heard the stories over the years, so I'm just kind of recounting what I've heard. Heard it from a friend who heard it from a friend who heard it from another. You've been messing around. what song is that?
REO Speedwagon.
Yeah, okay. The thing that I heard was used, or I believe I've read about, was the LED boards that light up. You can put messages and stuff on them. That people were trying to test this in like surgical areas, things of that nature, where people commonly claim to have out of body experiences, and they would put different messages.
Okay.
To change it up, so it's not like, oh, you know, well, you didn't read this, and it's not the same message for every person, where somehow it could, you know, somehow be transferred and they would know what to say. And they were able to change that up. I believe it came out as fairly inconclusive.
Okay.
That one specific study that did that sort of thing. Now, if he's referring to that, I don't know. I mean, it sounds fairly similar in line to that. Is there more things that go on? Are there more things that go on like that? I'm not sure. There very likely is. But that's a good question.
Yeah.
To open up to the medical community and see what their feedback is on that. If there's any stories surrounding that sort of thing happening.
Mm-hmm.
I really would like to hear more about that. Thanks for the question and thanks for your story. 855-853-4802. It's one of those fun things. Hey, yeah, there's no ghost here. Bam.
Right. You've got to love those moments where you have to be a parent not showing fear for the sake of your child. I hate those moments where you're scared shitless, but you have to be all brave and not even let them know that you're scared.
No, honey, it's completely normal for there to be two red glowing eyes outside your window. Let me get you some more Teddy Grahams.
Mm-hmm.
It'll all be good. All right, let's hear your story.
Hey guys, this is Christina from Atlanta. This is my third time trying to record. I keep getting cut off for some reason. I'm not sure why, but this is a bunk bed story. I'm just going to say it fairly quickly so I don't get cut off again. We got a bunk bed. My dad built it. Then weird shit started happening. We had a hallway ghost that you would see from the corner of your eye from sitting in the living room. You would hear typing in my room. I pulled the notepad up to see if we could get a typing or anything. Nothing would type. But I mean, there was definitely typing. The TV would turn on and off. I had a water bottle thrown in my head one night. The closet door is like one of those doors that was jammed shut, and you have to literally pull it with all of your force to open it. It would open like by itself all the time. Like no problem. No, like there was no like pulling on it. It was just open. I've had friends spend the night that their hair would be played with or someone would crawl in the bed with them multiple times. I've had, I've had cats pass away in the past and it would be like a cat jumped on the bottom.